Thank you. I tell you, when we landed, the atmosphere was different. Not just, you know, physically different and you feel warm or whatever. There was a general excitement in the air. And I believe, you know, I was thinking of some 10,000 reasons. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, right? So let us believe and continue to pray for this change. We have always said, Uba, change. Now then we say, Inikalila. So whatever it is, we have prayed, we have trusted God, and I believe God's hand was upon everything. And now it is all our privilege and also our responsibility as good citizens of Malaysia to pray for the shalom of God on Malaysia. You know what's shalom? Yeah, shalom is not just peace. When you say shalom to a person, when you greet them in Israel, it means that I wish you all that is well. So we are going to pray for the shalom of Malaysia. We're going to pray and continue to trust God that it is indeed a new day and that indeed God is going to do something wonderful. And when I was, my grandchildren were around the past 2 days, so when I look at them, I say, yeah, praise God, there is a future for my grandchildren. Now they are attending international schools, you know, and it costs a bomb to go. And my first most important prayer is that the education ministry will go back to educationists. Amen? Not politicians. Education is not something you play with every 5 years you change. We want educationists who really know what to do, to plan long term, so that we can be sure our maths and science won't suddenly become English, then after that become Malay, and then become English. No flip-flopping anymore. So praise God, I'm glad to be back. We had a very good time in Italy. You will see my husband, he's normally very fair. He got sunburned in Italy. Though it is cold, very unpredictable weather, worse than Malaysia. And we went to Pompeii. Okay, forgive me, I'll tell you a little bit. It was so hot. And you know, when you go and visit ruins, there are no trees, you know. There are no trees and there are no roofs because all the roofs have already fallen down, left pillars only. So he was baked. But thank God for a very smart wife. Every time you travel, bring an umbrella. We were the only two with umbrellas. The rest were all baked red like lobsters. Praise God. So anyway, I'm so glad to be back. I miss all of you and it's so good to worship God again in Tabernacle of Praise. I really enjoyed it. We visited many, many churches. And I tell you, when I look at the churches there, they are so beautiful. And it takes them hundreds of years to finish a church. 400 years. But the meticulous detail, the craftsmanship, I tell you, it is a wonder when you go there and you're so amazed that these people really love God, you know. That you can spend your whole life doing something and not seeing the end of it. And that's what we are as a church. All of us are like those people building those cathedrals. But we are investing into lives. And so on, our whole life will be here and we can never see the end of it. But when we leave, someone else will take over. And so it's very, very important for us to look into generations. We do not want the church to end with us. We want it to pass it on to generations, from generations to generations. And so it is good that today we are celebrating Mother's Day because mothers are into generations, cannot. I don't know whether it's genetically possible or if in the world of all men for the human species to survive, or in the world of all women, is it possible for the human species to survive? But one thing I know, this is a fact, no bluffing you. I watched a documentary many, many years ago, and it told about this African tribe this African tribe, they have very few women left. That means that as the people reproduce, they kept reproducing a lot of boys. I mean, in Chinese family, you say, wow, ta po ho, okay? But then as they produced more boys, there were less girls, right? And that particular tribe is dying because there are not enough women. I mean, you think of it logically, lah. One woman can bear one child 1 year. The most clever one, maybe 2 a year. Normal birth, don't talk about twins and triplets and all that. So there are maybe 4 or 5 men sharing one wife, you know. And which means when you are sharing one wife, 4 or 5 men can only produce the most next two offsprings out of 5 or 6 people. So of course the population is decreasing. On the other hand, some countries allow polygamy. One man has 4 wives, 1 year he can produce 4 already. So you see, women are very critical for the generations, for the your species, for your tribe, for your clan, for your family to expand. So when you have a baby girl, praise God, hallelujah, thank God for little girls, right? Okay, so today is Mother's Day, and for those women who are married with families, the role of wife and mother is our most important calling in Christ. Sometimes we think, you know, pastor is a very important calling, highest calling, they say. But each and every one of us women, we have that high calling. We have the opportunity to step into that high calling to be a wife and a mother. And in terms of significance, there is no job that can compete with what mothers are doing. Because you are shaping and molding a human being. A human being. Can you imagine that? You can go and send your dog for obedience school and all that. But this is a human being, you know. You are shaping and training it. And every time a child is born, a mother is also born. Right? A mother is also born. And when the mother sees her newborn child for the first time, those of you who have given birth, or even a father, when you see your child for the first time, what do you feel? You feel that awesomeness of God, that we made this, you know, this amazing little thing that can move, that can make noise, and can grab your heart and not let it go. That is the wonder. And an innate eternal bond is formed. For mothers especially, whatever you say, the father can say, you reared the child for 33 years. I also reared for 33 years. But I can tell you, I had 9 months more than my husband did. Why not? Yeah, I felt her. I felt her moving. I felt her heartbeat. I felt her kicking. And my stomach going all into all shapes and sizes and all that. That 9 months is something that is very hard for men to understand. Unless we plant a big alien inside you or whatever. It is very hard for men to understand. So if children are a blessing, let me tell you, mothers are God's loving gift to them. And I'd like to share with you something on some questions that were asked to some second grade school children. Right? They were asked why God made moms. Okay. First question, why did God make mothers? And one child said, she's the only one who knows where the scotch tape is. Right or not? Always, I cannot find. Mommy, where's the scotch tape? Mommy, where's the scissors? Mommy, where is my shoe? Mommy, where's my school bag? Mommy seems to know everything, right? And another child answered, mostly to clean the house, right? And the third child said, why did God make mothers? To help us out of there when we were getting born. No mother cannot be born already, right? So how did God make mothers? One child said, he used dirt just like the rest of us. Then the second child said, you know, look at the mother, so smart, so clever, and all this. Oh, you know how God made mothers? Magic, plus superpowers, and a lot of stirring, child said, God made my mom just the same like me. He just used bigger parts. This is probably a girl, right? Then what ingredients are mothers made of? Then one child said, God made mothers out of clouds. I can use for my slide already. I want to wish my, all the mothers Happy Mother's Day first, okay? All right. So God made mothers out of clouds. They're so soft and nice. And angel hair. And everything nice in the world. And one deck of mean. Mothers can be mean or so ever. Then they had to get their start from men's bones. Then they mostly use string, I think, another child said. Why did God give you your mother and not some other mom? Why this particular mom, huh? Then one child said, because we are related. Then another child said, God knew she likes me a lot more than other people's moms like me. Let me ask all mothers a question. All of us, even though we love all children, we will always love our children more than other children. Confession time. True or not? True, right or not? Whoever say, I know, I love other people's children more than my children, or something is very wrong with you. All mothers, we will love our children more. So this morning, we are going to use an acronym. MOTHER, M-O-T-H-E-R, to help us understand what mother is, okay? What a mother is. And this is based on an article that I found. It says, six truths about the role of moms by Dr. Tim Clinton. So let us look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for each other. We thank you for Malaysia. We thank you for mothers. We thank you for fathers. We thank you for each other. We thank you that we are a family of God, that we love one another, we care for one another. And today as we come before you, O Lord, Father, may you speak to us as a loving Heavenly Father. May you touch our hearts. May everyone who lives here, O God, experience a touch from you because you care for us. And so, Father, I surrender myself into your hands, and I surrender your people into your hands in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, most of us know from the Bible that God is God the Father. Amen? Yeah, God the Father. But surprisingly, the Bible also used a lot of mothering images to show the love of God. Isaiah said, God is less likely to forget us than a mother is to forget her nursing child. That means a mother who is nursing her child can forget the child faster than God would ever forget us. That is how much God loves us. Any mother who has nursed a child before will know, nursing a child is a very, very close relationship. I know my daughter, she does the craziest, most absurd things for her children. She will allow her son to sleep on top of her. I don't know how she slept for the first 2 years of her son's life. Sleep on top of her, and the breast is always available to the child, even in her sleep. So that is how close it is, though. Where the child is so attached to her. And God is saying that he loves us. The mother can forget her nursing child, but God will never forget us. That's how God loves us. And in another image, God also says to his people, as a mother comforts her child, so will I comfort you. You look at any, you go to any hospital, but nowadays, thank God, I see a change. In many hospitals, it's the mom who is comforting the child. Mom who sits up and take care of the child when the child is sick. But praise God, nowadays I see a lot of daddies doing that as well. Amen? Praise the Lord. I see men rising up to learn to have, to explore the feminine side of love. Okay? So, macho men do care for their children. Macho men do cry. Macho men do love in a very sweet and tender way. So, here God is also, and then Jesus, he looked to Jerusalem and all that, and he compares how much he cares for his people. He says he's like a mother hen. So this mothering side of God is something that we need to explore. And so much so special about mothers. And here I ask Mona to I gave Mona an assignment while I was away for 2 weeks. I told her to ask the children, the Sunday school, what does mother do that makes me feel good? And also another question, my mother is as pretty as, and you have to fill in the blanks, and so she videoed a few responses, all right? And now ask our media specialist to put on the video for us. Make it loud, huh? Because the first one is very soft. I'm very scared when I do videos for the church. You want to play? Okay, when it's ready. So the first word that an infant makes normally is mama, right or not? And which is why, or maybe baba, nowadays papa also, huh? But normally it's mama. And then, if you look at all the languages in the world, you find that ma is a very, is a word that is commonly used for mother. Like in the Chinese, it's mama. Then, even Malay says, mak, right? Then you have the Indians, I think they call it ama, right or not? And the Spanish will say madre. So, ama, ma is something that is very common. Oh, yeah. Now no sound. Okay, we are improving, okay? At least the thing is moving now. So, next one, the sound will come. Okay. So a mother's love is very special, and the child, when it calls mommy, mama, it is something very intimate. And so when you talk about mother's love, how do you describe a mother's love? As I was thinking about it, it brought to mind what King Solomon did, all right? An argument that occurred between two women. Are we ready? Okay, good old sound. But the first one is very soft, all right? So maybe you can skip the first one and I'll tell you what she said. No. Must hear what she says, is it? Okay. So there were, in King Solomon's time, he's the wisest man on earth, right? At that time. And I think even now. So there were two prostitutes who came before the king and they were arguing. And these two prostitutes were arguing over a baby. One of them said, you know, this woman and I, we stay in the same house. I had a baby while she was there. And 3 days after my child was born, she also had a baby. So now there are two babies, right? Two women with two babies. Then while we were alone, and we were all alone, and there was no one else in the house. During the night, that woman's son died. Because she lay on him. The mother sleep, rested on the child, and the child died. And when she, and what she did was she got up in the middle of the night and she came over, she took my child and she placed her dead child on me. Okay, this one now, the woman really sleep like the dead, until people take away a baby or something. But probably she was very tired. So the next morning I got up and I saw my baby was dead. Then I checked. Okay, mothers, even newborn babies, they know, you know which baby is death. And she checked and she said, hey, this isn't my baby. I think we can forget the video. Carry on. And then once you solve the problem, then you do it. Okay? So the next morning when she found that the baby was dead, she realized that, hey, this isn't my baby. And then she said, you stole my baby. So both of them, that woman said, no, my baby is alive. That is your baby, the dead one. And so both of them got into an argument and they ended up in front of Solomon. And Solomon listened to them, no, mine is living, yours is dead. No, mine is living, yours is dead. Well, how to decide like that, right or not? That's why in the hospital now they have got the identification bands. No identification bands at that time. So King Solomon said, very easy to solve this problem. Bring a sword, all right? And then he says, cut the baby in half, you take half, you take half. All right? And then what happened? The woman whose son was alive was filled with compassion for her son. All right? And she told the king, Lord, just give her the living baby. Don't kill him. It's the mother. The fact that if my child were to die, I would prefer I give him away. That is how much a mother would love. All right? A mother would love. But the other who is not the mother said, no problem, chop him into half. She have half, I have half. Why? Because it didn't matter to her. It's not her baby. But the one whose baby it was said, no, I would prefer to give away my baby. And so I'd like to talk to some of you who have been adopted. You might feel that you have been abandoned. You have been rejected by your natural parents. I'd like you to consider this. Maybe they were faced with a situation where they had to give you away. And thank God, someone received you. Someone chose you. And so today on Mother's Day, let us not have any resentment against the mother who has given us away. And neither should we be resentful towards our adoptive mothers. Some children get very upset. Why didn't you tell me that I've been adopted? That's because they love you so much. I'd like to present to you the point of view of a mother. It's because they love you so much. Both parents. See? So the commonest fallacy among women is that simply having children makes one a mother, which is as absurd as believing that having a piano makes one a musician. I know, because we have a piano for years in our house. I tried to learn the piano. I tried to learn the guitar. I am a musical dropout. Okay? I tried to learn the guitar, I think, 3 times. My husband also tried to teach me. He also gave up. Right? So, I couldn't. I'll do what Jacob does. Can sing or do it. Okay? So, having a piano doesn't make you a musician. It looks nice, right? Oh, you play the piano? So, a female guess about how much I know. So, having children does not make you a mother. But caring for children makes you one. Alright? Caring for a child. And we had wonderful women who have adopted. I was talking to a lady, and this lady, she had some infertility problems. You know, sometimes you can be married, most of you can be okay, there's nothing wrong with you, but you just can't conceive. And so they went for some treatments, and in the midst of the treatment, they started to apply for adoption. And when the adoption papers came, they said, adoption agency told them, hey, y'all are also getting on in age. Why don't you all don't adopt a baby? You adopt an older child. You know, older children are harder to be adopted, right? People want babies. Who wants a little one? And then come parents. The mother was a drug addict. The father had abandoned him. And the mother, because she's a drug addict, she had a lot of partners. And those partners, in some way, through the years, abused the child, this boy. And so they said, okay, because this friend of ours, she's a counselor, a professional counselor, psychiatrist. So she said, I'll take up the challenge. And so they signed the papers to adopt this child. And during that time, they were doing fertility treatments, and suddenly they found out she was also 3 months pregnant. Now, if you were in that position, what would you do? No need the adopted one ready, lah. I have my own ready, right? But God gave her such a big heart. She said, it's okay, I will adopt the six-year-old. So within 6 months, she had a six-year-old new son and a baby. And this six-year-old child, because of the abuse, was terrible. There was one time where she had to climb into her car and drive off with her baby because he was getting violent and, you know, going to kill them and all that. And so she had to run away before her husband came back. So that is what it means, you know, when you adopt someone, that she would go through all that. Now the child is a teenager, and of course, teenage problems come in. So, and they had to send him for counseling until the counselor said, I think you better give him up. This child is very difficult to handle with all the abuse and all that. But she kept on. And the child is now a teenager. So you see, a mother, you don't have to give birth to a baby to be a mother. You can adopt one, right? And when you adopt, you are doing someone a great favor. Can you imagine this child who is so difficult? If he had not been adopted at 6 years old, what would he have been now as a teenager? He would probably be on the streets. He would probably be killing. He would probably be stealing. He would probably be in big trouble. But he was saved. So adoption is a good way. There's a book written on adoption for Christian parents, all right? So we cannot also discount the importance of spiritual mothers, especially in the church. All of us, your children are not just your children. Your children are my children too. I remember there was one time my daughter came back and she told me something about a friend of hers. And this friend, we are fellow believers, brothers and sisters in Christ. And then she said, my friend said, don't tell your mother, so that your mother won't tell my mother what I did. But we felt it was very dangerous because she is telling her mother that she came to our house, but actually she went to her boyfriend's house. So what I did was, I told the mother. And all of us have to look up for our children. When you see one of them doing something wrong, don't say, I don't want to be the chow lang. I better don't tell. I tell you, I see any of you doing any nonsense, I'll go and tell your mother. I'll go and tell your father. Alright? We care for one another. We are all spiritual mothers here. Even if you are not married or what, we care for our people, alright? All the people here. So M is for mom, mothers. Can we carry on with the slides and forget about the video? Alright? So the next word is O, alright? We're going to use the acronym. First one is mom. You don't have to be a mother to be a mom, alright? Next one is others. Now the word mother is used nearly 300 times. Next slide, please. In the Bible. It's 300 times in the Bible, you know. And in the Strong's Concordance, the word literally means an intimate relationship. An intimate relationship. I think all of us have very intimate, have very intimate relationship with our mothers. And this relationship, it says it bestows benefits on another. That means this is a very giving relationship. It's a relationship that blesses others. And that's why mothers live for others. Okay? And there is no sacrifice too great for her child. I think we have heard stories of people, you know, being caught. There was this woman who was caught in a blizzard in South Wales. And then she couldn't escape and she knew she was going to die. What did she do? She took off all her outer clothes, that means her coat, everything, and she bundled her baby with all the clothes. And then she hugged the baby and she crouched over the baby to use her body's warmth to keep the baby warm. And when they found her, she has already passed away. She has already died. But the baby was alive. And this baby later lived to be a Prime Minister of Great Britain, David Lloyd George. So mothers will do all sorts of things. And I've read in the newspapers where mothers who are crushed under the earthquake, you know, and the buildings are upon them. What they do is the child is hungry, the child is thirsty. What do? They bite their fingers and let the child suck their blood. Of course, it sounds very gruesome. But if your child is thirsty, what would you do? And that was what the mother did. And if you look at the way mothers serve others, mothers work as many as 90 hours a week, it says. And their job description defies logic. They do the dishes, they change the diapers, they face the drama of the, you know, children throwing tantrum and all that. And nowadays, also have to discipline the child. She is a problem solver. Mommy, where is this? Mommy, where is that? I know, because my sister also another one. Or anybody, you ask any mother, the child will come back, Mommy, my school want me to have a show and tell. I must bring a hat. No hat. What to do? The poor mother run around like crazy at the supermarket to try to get a hat. She is a nurse. When the child is sick, she must nurse the child. She is a chauffeur. I know when I was, my daughter was still studying, there was one day I checked my speedometer, you know, I drove more than 100 km that day. I think more than a Grab car driver. Just fetching her, you know, ballet class, back, go to tuition, back, rush to another tuition, back, all that. More than 100 kilometers, I don't know where I went, also still around Penang Island, okay? And she's a cheerleader. Wow, every concert you also go, mother. Every time she ran, you know, I'm a poor athlete, I cannot run, all right? Teacher always say, your legs so long can run, but then I run, always end up belakang. But my daughter can run, praise the Lord. So when she went for sports, wow, I was there cheering for her. Wow, living vicariously through her. So I enjoyed it. I was her cheerleader. There are times when you will weep with frustration, and then there will be times of joy when you weep. When she graduates, when she gets married. Huh? Do you say, daughter get married, also cry? Of course, that's why I feel a cry. So motherhood is an honor and a privilege. But it is synonymous with servanthood. Next slide. Motherhood is a great honor and privilege, yet it is synonymous with servanthood. You are actually a servant. Mothers are servants. Whether you are awake at night, nursing your baby, or you are spending your time and money on less than grateful teenagers. I remember myself, you know, that when I go to KL, to visit her when she was studying there. People say, hey, you go KL, you go shopping. I never go shopping. I go shopping. I don't shop for myself. I go and then my daughter will say, this is nice. Buy for her. No? Then everything you want, no need. Buy for her will do. You ask any mother, that's what they will do. Why not? You will buy for your child and not for yourself. Okay? And of course, preparing meals and constantly putting others before yourself. And one preacher said, there is one word that can describe all mothers. All mothers. I said, what is that one word? So good that one word can describe all mothers. That one word is tired. Yes or no? You are tired, you know. You are tired, especially if you have a small baby. Motherhood can bring you much joy. But it can also be very boring, especially if you are a stay-at-home mom. You stay at home, every day you talk to a two-year-old, your brain also degenerate, become like two-year-old. Why not? You crave for some adult conversation. So you need to learn to balance, all right? Then you're exhausted. But nothing else will ever make you as happy or as sad, as proud or as tired. Because nothing is quite as hard, here it says, as helping a person develop his own individuality. Your child is going to be an individual. He's not going to be another you, right? Especially while you struggle to keep your own. I ended up being Pam's mother. No name. Who are you? Oh, you are Gabriel's father. Oh, who are you? Oh, excuse me, Daniel's mom, right? That's how they address you. Daniel's mom, Daniel's father, and you lose your personality, you know. You are no longer you. You've lost your name. You become an appendage of something else. And no one deserves a special day all to herself more than mothers. A cartoon showed a psychologist talking to his patient. So this patient is a woman now, obviously. Then the psychologist, after hearing her, says, let's see, you spend 50% of your energy on your job, 50% on your husband, and 50% on your children. You all know how to count or not? 50% on the job, 50% on the husband, 50% on the children. I think I see your problem. You are working on minus 50%, you know. Where is it going to come from? Right? So, for mothers, you are tired. You are tired, especially if you are a working mom. And I always am very amazed, and I always want to commend husbands who will help their wives, especially if you have a working wife. You know, there are some husbands, they come back, tiao kopi lai. Yeah, you make your own coffee lah. Your wife also work 8 hours, you know. Come back and some more. You can sit in front of the TV and ask for the coffee, like, where she has to mop the floor. She has to, some of them, some of you have to cook some more. I'm very privileged. I'm a very happy wife because my husband said no need to cook. He'll take me out to eat. Okay? But then for some of you, you have to come back, mop the floor. You have to cook the dinner and all that and wash the clothes. And husband sit in front, watch Malaysia TV. What is the government? Who is the new cabinet minister and all that? So sometimes you get very gram, right? No, very frustrated. You get discouraged, and sometimes you just feel overwhelmed. Like, you're going to drown, you're going to die already. So you feel very unappreciated, and sometimes you feel very inadequate. Why other women can do so? The Chinese called kamka. You know what's kamka or not? Wow, they all like octopus, got many hands, you know, can do this, can mop the floor, can cook all at the same time. I will probably burn everything and then the floor also doesn't get mopped. And then you feel very overwhelmed. But then, what happens? Your children don't notice it. Some of them complain, mommy, I don't want to eat this. Why you cook this again? Huh? And they don't thank you. But, you know who sees? Who sees? Next slide, please. God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown him as you have helped his people. Who are his people? Your husband, your children, and continue to help them. God sees. God sees. And one day you will receive your true reward. Sometimes you think, I will wait a long, long time already. When is it coming? But then one day you will receive your true reward. And for every prayer, every sleepless night, every tear you cry, every encouraging word you give, and every expression of love that you have showered of them, you are going to be rewarded. And it's going to be better than all the flowers, the candies, the chocolate, which only make us fatter, right? That you are going to receive on Mother's Day. So, one caution to mothers, and that's what I told my daughter also this Mother's Day. Take care of yourself. Sometimes, being mothers, we always give so much that we forget to take care of yourself. You know, when I learned this when I became a pastor. I realized that I cannot take care of other people if I do not take care of myself. You go up on the plane, they'll tell you, okay, these are safety procedures. If you see the mask drop down, what must you do? You wear it. Wear it first. before you bear for your dependent.
And that same principle applies in our lives as mothers, as anybody who is serving the Lord. You know, for all leaders also, it applies to you. Take care of yourself first. If you don't take care of yourself, you cannot take care of others. So mothers, you must find that time. And the songs we sang this morning, which says, God, you are the strength. It is God who is our strength. And we need to find time, the alone time, to feed ourselves spiritually so that the spirit man is strong in order that we can accomplish all that we want to do physically. Alright? So, caution to mothers. Take care of yourself. Self-care is so important. So, not only are moms just moms, they are caring for others. Mother is also a teacher. Solomon admonishes us. Okay? He says, listen, my son, to your father's instruction. So, this message is not just for mothers only. Children, you must listen to your daddy as well. Okay? And do not forsake your mother's teaching. And it's so beautifully said. It says, they will be a garland to grace your head and a chain to adorn your neck. Maybe nowadays, macho boys, they will say, put flowers on the head, a chain on the neck, so girly. But this means you are going to be honored, all right? It's going to be something that is going to grace you, that is going to make you handsomer, okay? So, this is what it means, okay? So, we should not forsake your mother's teaching. Mothers teach. We know that the early years of a child is very important, the first 5 years. So, in the first 5 years, their attitudes are being shaped, their personalities, habits, their principles, their self-esteem, their IQ is all formed during the first 5 years. And Robert Fulghum, in All I Really Need to Know, I Learned in Kindergarten, he wrote, all I really need to know about how to live and what to do and how to be, I learned in kindergarten. Kindergarten, before you go to school. Wisdom was not at the top of the graduate school mountain, but there in the sand pile at Sunday school. These are the things I learned, okay? If you translate it into adult language, it really applies to all of us. These are the things he learned. He says, share everything. Why not? Mother always says, share, must share, okay? Play fair. Don't hit people. Put things back where you found them. Clean up your own mess. Don't take things that aren't yours. People's money cannot take. Alright? Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. Wash your hands before you eat. Flush. No flush what? Warm cookies and cold milk are good for you. In Malaysia, maybe roti canai. Live a balanced life. Learn some, think some, draw and paint and sing and dance and work every day some. So, good dance, just now, so easily everybody can do, right? Now, that's why I sit in front. You sit inside there, very hard to dance. How to step forward, you go and kiss the chair already. So, we need more people to fill up this role. My mission is to fill up this role. Okay? All the pastors here, you must fill up this role. Okay? And when you go out in our next one, take a nap every afternoon. It's very important. Recharge your battery. When you go out in the world, hey, that's what my staff do, After lunch, when the lights are off, all of them are leaning back on their chair. They have about 10 minutes cat nap. And I think it's good to recharge your batteries. When you go out in the world, watch out for traffic. Hold hands and stick together. Be aware of wonder. Remember the little seed in the styrofoam cup. The roots go down and the plant grows up. And nobody really knows how or why. But we are all like that. Okay? The wonder to see a miracle in something. God is a God of miracles. Goldfish and hamsters and white mice and even the little seed in the styrofoam cup, they all die. So do we. And then remember the Dick and Jane books and the first word you learn, the biggest word of all, look. Learn to observe the world. Then he goes on to say, take any do not take don't take things that aren't yours. I mean, don't steal. Why not? You do not go and covet other people's things. Okay? And apply it to your family life or your work or the government or your world, and it holds true and clear and firm. Think what a better world it will be if we all followed all those rules. Right? Think how better it would be. And if all governments followed all this, don't kill people, clean up your own mess, put things back where you found them, and all that, if we only followed all of that. All those things we learn in the river. Yeah. So we are very thankful for to mothers for the instruction and correction. But they teach us through example and exhortation. Okay? They are investing their time to raise godly children. And for us, it's even more important. As people of God, we are raising a godly generation. And I'm so glad to see all our children are here in the church. All right? With us, serving God. An old Spanish proverb says, an ounce of mother is worth a pound of clergy. That means a mother's work is more of more significance than when they are big lady, then you send them to pastor for counseling. Pastor, go and counsel my son. You see why he's like that? He's like that because when he was young, before 5 years old, you never taught him a little bit. Alright? So you must start from young. And in 2 Timothy 1:5, this is the importance of generational input. In 2 Timothy 1:5, Paul wrote, I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. So you see, there was this faith that came from the grandmother to the mother and was now input into Timothy. And Timothy's faith was grounded in the godly women in his life. And here it talks about a grandmother. And I think grandparents are very important. And I always look at Brother Alan with Alvin and the family and Sister Suyin. I tell you why. Alvin is a very fortunate man. His children have been entrusted into his father and mother's hands. And they are godly grandparents. You know. I tell you, there are things that they have imparted into those young lives that you cannot get anywhere. You can send to the best preschool, you know, what nowadays are bright kids, then you don't know, they activate your this brain, cognitive, and don't know what, left brain, right brain, then no brain or whatever brain. So, a lot of things, right? But then nothing is more important than the input of godly parents, right? So, grandparents, if you have parents, especially young people getting married, if you have parents who are Christian, cepat have children, so that grandparents can input in them. Because when too old already, a bit difficult, you have to take care of the grandparents, not the grandparents take care of the grandchildren. Now, I'm not saying that you have children and dump them to the grandparents. Grandparents also nowadays are very smart. I play with my grandchildren, I don't take care. Like us, because far away, so very convenient excuse. They come, we play with them, spoil them, and after that send them back to KL. But then we still input in them, alright? Things that are important. Now, when you look at that verse, it talks about the grandmother, it talks about the mother. What happened to the father? Did you ever talk about that? There was no mention of him. And we only know that he was a geek. And probably a non-believer. But then, you see, just the mother and the grandmother can have so much impact on Timothy. And I want to encourage single parents, especially single mothers. You might think that, I am alone. What can I do? How can I mold this life? How can I impart into this life? It's possible. It is possible. Single moms, God is with you. God is with you every step of the way. And my heart goes out to you. Because I know, if you were to do the whole parenting thing alone, I would probably have gone crazy. But God is with you. God is faithful. He has been faithful and He will continue to be faithful. So let me tell you a story about a single mother. Now, a single mother sometimes need not be a divorcee or a widow. Sometimes the husband can be a non-existent husband, you know, run away, or always traveling on work or something. So there was this, all of us know about Charles and John Wesley, not? You know, John and Charles Wesley? You know Wesley Methodist Church? They are the founders of the Methodist denomination. Their mother was Susanna Wesley. She is a very famous woman in Christian history. She has these two sons. In fact, she has a lot of children, right? A lot of children. And her husband was Samuel. Samuel was a minister. You would think pastor must be very good. Already, right? Not. But frankly speaking, he was not much of a man. He couldn't get along with people. Can you imagine? Pastor cannot get along with people. Go and fight with all the members. Right? He couldn't get along with people. And he spent his life serving congregations that didn't pay him well. Of course, I go fight with them how they want to pay you well. Yeah, you're not. At least I friend you. You rephrase a little bit. Make sure I have enough clothes to wear and food to eat, right? And then he go and fight with all his members. Of course, they didn't pay him well. And on top of that, he was terrible with money. He ended up in the debtor's prison, leaving Susanna to fend for herself. Can you imagine? Ini macam punya pastor, you mau? And he was a hothead. He gets angry very fast. Once Susanna and Samuel, family altered. And then Susanna said, amen. He didn't like the way she said amen. I mean, how many days can you say amen also? I don't know lah. But anyway, he got upset that he didn't like the way she said amen. And so he left the house. And they argued and eventually he went his way. And Samuel was gone all the time. So actually she was a single mom, right? Not because of all his traveling, because he was in debtor's prison and all the marital problems. And Susanna was the one who taught her children not only the Bible, but everything about living a successful and good life. And in her biography, someone wrote her, although she never preached a sermon or published a book, or founded a church, she is known as the mother of Methodism. Why? Because two of her sons, John Wesley and Charles Wesley, as children, consciously or unconsciously will, apply the example and teaching and circumstances of their home life. You see how she can impact her children so much. And I want to tell single parents, God is with you. God is with you. That you are here today, God has been with you. And God will be with you to carry you through. So mothers, all mothers, you have a great opportunity. You have a great opportunity and you wield great power and influence in the lives of your children. And the most important thing that you can do for them is to pray for them. Pray for them and be a good example. Make sure that as you walk in the Lord, you know, when it comes to taking care of yourself, this is where that walk with the Lord comes in. When you immerse yourself in the Word of God, you get strengthened. When you pray, you find strength that comes in. And your children will see and know that God is real. Okay, God is real. And it applies for all of us. Whether you are a mother or not, if you find that things are beyond you, things are overwhelming, things are coming to a head where you don't know whether you can carry on further, come back to God. Alright? It's God who will strengthen you. So I appreciate all mothers who pray for the children, who turn the hearts of the children to the Lord, and all the tears and travail you went through. So the next one, moms, others, mom is a teacher, honor. The first commandment with promise says, honor your father and mother, that it may go well with you, and that you may enjoy long life on earth. There is such promise there. We are to honor your father and mother. I think God is very specific. Huh? He just didn't say honor your parents. I don't like all this gender-friendly Bibles. If it says father, then say father. If it says mother, then say mother. And the word honor means weighted glory. Weighted value. That is, among all the values that you have, things that you value, to honor is to give them the greatest weight. That means, in everything, your parents should be the heaviest. And when we want to give honor, we should give them the most honor. Of course, besides God. But the Bible sadly says, nowadays, in Proverbs 30:11, it says, there are those who curse their fathers and do not bless their mothers. I mean, this is such a shameful thing, don't you think so? Right, that you would curse your father and not bless your mother. Now, no mother is sinless or perfect. I confess, I am not sinless, I am not perfect. But we have to be thankful for the one that God gave us. Alright? Even though they fail to live up to our expectations, even though sometimes we feel they did something wrong, we still thank God for them. If not for them, there would be me, right? And here are some simple ways to honor your mom, not only your mom, but your dads as well. Spend time with her. You ask Auntie Ang. If you ask Auntie Ang, she will be so glad you go and spend time with her. I think that is the most important thing that people want. To spend time. Old people, especially older one, I'm over 70, I'm still young, okay? So, spend time with them. When you spend time with them, it tells that you are valuable. That means, you know, time is money, you know, nowadays. People say that you take time to go and see your grandfather. You take time to go and see your grandmother. That's why I appreciate the Tia twins. The way they, you know, take care of their grandpa and all that. That's amazing, you know. That's something that warms my heart. Yeah, we should applaud things that we see, that's good. Right? And it means that it tells your grandpa that he's valued and that you are also creating moments. Moments that you will remember. Moments that are going to encourage you. Then you also listen to them. Sometimes they say, ayah, same old story. You want to tell me the same story? Ayah, oh, every time during the war, I can tell you the story, but then you still listen to them. Listen because these words are a window to a bygone era rich with story. There are certain times when my sister and I would talk, and then we say, we should have asked mommy, you know, at that time. But at that time, never asked her. Never thought of asking her. So now, if you have time with your parents, my daughter is very good. Oh, my husband is good. I'm not that good. My husband will tell my daughter, last time we lived in Alaska, we lived in a house. Behind the house is the paddy field. Right? And after the paddy field is the railway track. And after the railway track is the rubber estate. Correct? He tells so much until the mother also knows. And then he'll tell his stories. How about if y'all never sat with him, he does some very horrible things. So, you know, how they skin a monitor lizard and all the naughty things he does. He will tell her all those stories. And those stories will be stories that she can tell her children. Then she asked me, Mommy, what story do you have? I have no story. I only live in 14 Taylor Road. Live there, and then we only play. I remember only one thing. Grace, Terence Lau, his wife, Grace, is my neighbor opposite. And she has a brother, Daniel, who occasionally comes to church. I only remember one thing I did. Because we always fight, he was torturing me, and I was torturing him. That's all I did. Nothing much to tell my daughter. There's a bad example, so I don't tell her. Listen to all these stories. And if they keep telling you the same story, change direction. And you said, then how you meet grandma, huh? Okay? Then what was your first date like, huh? Ask other questions, all right? And then you'll find out more. And the third thing is, if you spend time with them, you listen, and sometimes we need to forgive our parents. We have to forgive. It is not easy. It is not easy, but we need to forgive. Because they are not perfect. There is no perfect mother. And after all, how many years more are you going to spend with her? Right? Might as well forgive. And at least enjoy the next few years together. And bless her desires. Sometimes we do not know. But do you know, your mother might have given up a lot of things in order that you can have the life that you want? If they have, don't have children, your parents could have gone around the world, go and visit, go on tours, but they had to pay for your education, they had to pay for your college, they had to buy a car for you some more. Nowadays, everything parents must supply, you know. And nowadays, with the cost of houses so high, maybe must pay the deposit for the house also. If not, we can go around the world already, you know. So it's time to bless their desires. So there was once in our office, we do exchange of like secret Santa like that. So you are supposed to write three things that you want. So sure they won't give me, and how can they give me? I put a trip to Langkawi, and then I wrote a few others, less important one, but I wanted to go to Langkawi. I don't know whatever for, I should have put Italy. Anyway, I put a trip to Langkawi. And then, on the Christmas tree, there was a present with Air Asia packing, you know. See, this one must be, no, I asked for Langkawi, so pretend I can put Air Asia and all that. Then I opened it up. Hey, it was really a ticket for Langkawi. Present from my daughter. See, so sometimes, it's good that you bless your parents. You know there's something that they want. Something that they like, something that they have coveted and dreamed of, but they have always put up, maybe another time, my daughter needs to do this, my son needs this. You know, our parents do that, you know. We keep delaying. And it's time that we grant them the desires of their heart. And also for all the time that they have prayed for you, it's good that you pray for them, especially if they are non-believing parents. Pray for their salvation. Ask God, God, I want. You are a God of miracles. No, this year, I believe, is a year of miracles for us. Amen? Let us increase our faith. Let us trust God. Believe God for big things. I think God has shown us, you know, step by step, every step of the way, that He is a wonderful God. A God who can do marvelous things that are above our imagination. If only we can believe. And so let us move in faith. Let us pray for our unbelieving parents. And amaze her with kindness and love. Surprise. Give them a good surprise. Not bad surprise. Bad surprise can heart attack, die, you know. So give good surprises. And tell her how grateful you are. Sometimes they say, what for to tell? Right? It is important to tell. Why? Because sometimes it might be too late by the time you want to tell. Okay? And the next thing about mother is, she is an encourager. Mothers are the best encouragers. They are your cheerleader. Any performance you do, whether you do well or don't do well, they are there to cheer for you. And they are your supporter through thick and thin. Mother is always there to support you. Mother is like, how can you support like that? Send her lah and all that, okay? So Pablo Picasso said this. My mother said to me, see how the mother cheered him on, if you become a soldier, you'll be a general. If you become a monk, you will end up as a pope. Don't be a monk. Monk already, then cannot have children already. If you become a monk, you'll end up a pope. Instead, Pablo Picasso said, I became a painter and wound up as Picasso. Better than anything else. You know, because the mother believed in him, believed in her. And all of us, we believe in our children. And sometimes it's not academic, you know. My daughter never really shone in school. Not like some people are so clever, always top of the class, how many A's, guarantee A1, all that. No, but she shone in university. Because university is where you find your niche. You find your passion. You find the thing that really interests you. And that's where you will shine. Okay? So it's never too late. It's never too late to cheer on your children. Because our education system nowadays only rewards a certain type of learner. But all of us are different types of learners. Some of us are kinetic, must work with hands. Don't work with hands, cannot go into the brain. But some of us look only can really. Some of us must hear. So there are different ways of learning, but our education system does not encourage all those ways. And we find that some people do not excel. But when you really go into the field that you enjoy, you like, where your passion is, that's where you blossom, that's where you bloom. And Paul says, this is what mothers do, Paul says, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone. That's what mothers do. We encourage the timid. Don't be afraid. Can one. You can do it. Huh? Then we push our children to go and do it. Then we go. But then in the end, they do it also. Then help the weak. The one who is weaker, we help them. And we are patient. So there was once a little boy who forgot his lines in a Sunday school presentation. Okay? And so, as usual, a mother is in charge. Okay? Directing. So she gestured and formed the words with her lips, but she went blank. Sometimes it happens, you go blank. And that's when you open your mouth and ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. But probably this boy doesn't know that. So she leaned forward and whispered, I am the light of the world. That's what you should say. I am the light of the world. And the child suddenly, my mother is the light of the world. And everybody clapped their hands. You see, that's what mothers do. We prompt our children, we make sure they do their best. And no matter how smart or how intelligent your child is, kids need to be encouraged. They need to be encouraged by family members. They need to be encouraged by the church, friends. Alright? They need to be encouraged by their neighbors. And you find that kids that are being encouraged are happier and they have greater confidence. I can do it. Then next time, I can do better. Alright? But at the same time, warning to parents. Be aware of overpraising your child. Sometimes we want to encourage them, Then we keep praising, whether do a slip shot work, didn't finish his work, or very good, very clever. And then the child thinks he's so smart, so clever, so very good. And then when he goes into the real world, he finds that he's at the bottom of the pile. And there is a very rude awakening. So be realistic when you praise a child, alright? Be realistic when you praise a child. I don't believe in overpraising. And they have a sense of entitlement. My teacher, I never say I'm good. No, I did my work. No, but then you go and check, everybody's work so good, you're so lousy. Of course, teacher didn't praise you, right? And there's nothing. And the most important thing as an encourager is to tell your child, I love you. Not only when they are doing good. Not only when they are performing well. All the time. When your child comes back crying, I failed my exam. I love you, I love you. Why? Because if he has tried his best, he didn't do something and then he forgot something and then that pulled down his mark. I love you. Tell the child that you love him and that you will hug him and you appreciate the effort. So that the child doesn't come out with the approval syndrome where he must always prove himself. If I don't do well, my father doesn't love me anymore. If I don't do well, my mother doesn't love me. And he'll go around being a people pleaser because he's seeking approval. The child must know that he is being approved because you are my child. You are my child. Okay? And the last one is relationship. Okay? Jesus, when he hung on the cross, all of you very happy are coming to an end already. There was one person at the foot of the cross, and that was his mother. She stood with him at Calvary. And there was a revered president of Lancaster Theological Seminary who said to his class of seminarians, "A mother's love will go with her son whether he goes to the governor's chair or the electric chair." True or not? Even the vilest murderer who is being, you know, going for his death sentence, mother is always there. Mother is always there. And so Mary was there at the foot of the cross. Can we have the next slide? When Jesus saw his mother there, you see, even in his agony, Jesus remembered his mom. And the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. He cared for his mother even with his last breath. Jesus cared for his mom. And so Dr. Tim Kinden, where I took this acronym from, he says, "A relationship begun in the manger, confirmed in a miracle, and declared even in mourning. Mother." That is a picture of the Pietà taken by Kenny at the St. Peter's Basilica at the Vatican City. I tell you what, that is mother's love here. That until the end, a mom is always a mom. It doesn't matter how old you are. Even when I was 50 years old, my mother still cares for me. When I have a headache, she will still massage my head for me. And I believe there was once when I had a tummy ache, she applied the minyak onion for me. A mother is a mother no matter how old you are. She is the one, you know, when we get married, we have the vows, "I love you for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, till death do you part." You know, the first promise that this verse can be applied to, that this promise can be applied to, is to a mother. A mother will love you for better or for worse. Even the vilest murderer has a mother who loves him. For richer, for poorer, whether you are rich or poor, it doesn't matter. My mother always tells us when we take her out for dinner, he says, "Hey, you like we don't go to the expensive places. Go to the cheap places." All she wants was some time with us. And in sickness or in health, to death was part. So on her way back to Penang to vote at the GE14, Pam WhatsApp us a photo of her cradling her younger son. Can you see? She WhatsApp me this photo and she put there, okay, she said, "3 years, 8 months and still my baby." That's her youngest son, Ethan. "3 years, 8 months and still my baby." And I messaged her at the bottom, "33 years and 5 months. My baby. She will always be my baby because I'm a mother. And for all of you, never forget, you will always be your mother's baby. You will always be your mother's baby." And then Moscam says, "God said, I need someone who can shape a soul and find shoes on Sunday and get grass pains out of Levi's. Someone with a heart strong enough for toddler tantrums and teenage testing, yet broken enough to fall on her knees and pray, pray, pray." So God made a mother. So as we remember our moms today, there is no one more influential or more powerful on earth than a mother. So never, never, if you are a mother, doubt the value of your calling. And Dr. Tim Clinton wrote, he says, "Life didn't come with a manual. It came with a mother. God didn't, when we come out, give us a manual." Of course, the Bible is our manual in life. But God gave us mothers. And so I want to end before I ask the young people, this year is going to be different. My daughter was saying, how can they ask you to preach on Mother's Day? I said, we take turns. So last year, Pastor Koye, so this year, you know. But this year, I'm so glad I got an offer from Teresa and her buddy to pray for mothers. So as I invite them up, let me share with you what somebody said. Somebody said it takes about 6 weeks to get back to normal, get back your shape, after you had a baby. Somebody doesn't know that once you are a mother, normal is history. Life is no longer normal. Somebody said you learn how to be a mother by instinct. Somebody never took a three-year-old shopping. You know how mad it can be. Somebody said being a mother is boring. Somebody never rode a car driven by a teenager without license. Somebody said, if you are a good mother, your child will turn out good. Somebody thinks a child comes with directions and a guarantee. There's no guarantee. We have some very, very good, godly parents whose children have gone bad. Good example, God the Father. Yet, two children, Adam and Eve, and see what happened to them. So there are no guarantees. Somebody said, good mothers never raise their voice. Somebody never came out the back door just in time to see her child hit a golf ball through the neighbor's kitchen window. You know, mothers, at least once in your life, you will scream at your children, can you do that? No crazy things our children will do. Somebody said, you don't need an education to be a mother. Somebody never helped a fourth grader with his math. And especially nowadays with the new syllabus, I think it's a big headache for mothers to help children with the work. Somebody said you can't love the second child as much as you love the first. Somebody doesn't have two children. I look at my daughter. She will do the craziest things. I told you she will let her son sleep on her, right? So when she had the second one, I said, start from young. The first one, we send him out of the room already. Let him sleep alone. He said, cannot. Cannot, why? Because what I did for the first one, I must do for the second one. I said, you crazy lah. You think the child know whether he sleep inside the room or on sleeping on you? He won't know one. We make life easier for you. You learn the lesson already. He said, no, cannot. And so the second one also sleep on her. You will always love your children. Somebody said a mother can find all the answers to her child-rearing questions in books. Don't read a lot of books, right? Somebody never had a child stuff beans up his nose or in his ears. Somebody said the hardest part of being a mother is labor and delivery. Somebody never watched a baby get on the bus for the first day of kindergarten or on a plane headed for an S. I cried when my daughter left to study in KL. She was 17. It was too soon. She was too young. And I was too attached to her. And I cried buckets. Buckets. I know, literally buckets of tears. I would go into her room and then I would smell. Not that my daughter is smelly. Lah. But then, you know, her bath lotion and the things she used, her shampoo and her clothes, smells of her, and I go in and I smell. That's what a mother does. You never know. You all go off on an adventure, but you leave your mother behind, and your mother goes into your room and smell. That's my daughter. Somebody said a mother can do her job with her eyes closed and one hand tied behind her back. Somebody never organized 7 green brownies to sell cookies. Somebody said a mother can stop worrying after her child gets married. I am married already, no need to worry. Somebody doesn't know that marriage adds a new son or daughter-in-law to a mother's heartstrings. Now you pray not only for your daughter, not pray for her son-in-law, not only for your son, not your daughter-in-law. Okay? And then you've got grandchildren, more people to pray for. Somebody said a mother's job is done when her last child leaves home. Somebody never had grandchildren. Okay? And somebody said, your mother knows you love her. Yeah, she knows her, she knows her. So you don't need to tell her. Somebody isn't a mother. Your mother needs to hear you say that you love her. So even as we thank God for this precious gift of mothers, we want to honor her, we want to love her, and we want to cherish her. A young, awkward boy grew up in Southern California. A lot of stories are there. Plagued by a learning disability, it's what we call dyslexia, right? But with his mother's encouragement and admonishment, he became a strong and capable leader. Years later, he was commanding thousands of young Americans at war. When General George S. Patton found himself in North Africa, grappling with the German army, his thoughts on the battlefield were often of his mother. It was his mother, he often told colleagues, who ingrained in him the leadership qualities that he was to become famous for. Listen, his only regret was that he never expressed sufficient appreciation to her. Darling Mama, he began in a letter he wrote after her death, in words that pained him. Darling Mama, you are still very near. I never showed you in life the love I really felt, nor my admiration for your courage. I hope all of us never have to write such a letter. So today, tell your mother that you love her. Teresa? Teresa is going to pray for all the mothers.
Can I invite all the mothers and the wives in this church to come forward?